until the beginning of the 16th century, when Spanish and Portuguese navigators discovered the Pacific Ocean, Europeans were unaware of its existence. Later, a succession of English, French, and Dutch explorers charted hundreds of islands and archipelagos scattered throughout the immense ocean. But the Western world knew nothing of Australia until James Cook discovered it in 1770. The English considered this southern land as nowhere, and a land belonging to no one, that is, until the white man arrived, despite the fact that the Aborigines had been living there for more than 30,000 years. Australia is situated entirely in the southern hemisphere, bordered to the east by the Pacific Ocean and to the west by the Indian Ocean. This veritable island continent of nearly 8 million square kilometers is comprised of 6 states and 2 autonomous territories. Our cruise ship, the Song of Flower, sails the Great Barrier Strait that flows along the coast of Queensland and then curves westward as far as Darwin, the capital of the Northern Territories. Our journey begins in the south, in the province of New Wales, in Sydney. The South Pacific, 155 degrees longitude east, 35 degrees latitude south. Having embarked from New Zealand, the Song of Flowers sails into the port of Sydney. The English colony established in Australia after its discovery by Captain Cook had not increased in size. In fact, it was the signing of the American Declaration of Independence that prompted a marked expansion. It now became impossible for England to exile its convicts to America. Instead, the first fleet sailed to Australia. In January 1788, the ships entered a magnificent bay where the English soldiers unloaded 750 convicts who were to become the founders of the future city of Sydney. Some 2 centuries later, this former colony of convicts is today a thriving city of 4 million people, whose identity is expressed through its creative and harmonious blend of architecture and sea.
I would suggest that the reason that the Harbour Bridge and the Opera House have created an identity for the city, because visual icons are the source of city symbols this century, and in many respects the bridge does more than bridge the harbour. And the Opera House does more than house opera. Both were controversial, both took many years to be agreed to, and it's maybe the pain of birth which ultimately becomes the embrace of childhood.
From 1788, the waves of deportees arriving from London jails continued to swell in numbers. Paintings from that period ignore the appalling conditions which the soldiers and convicts endured, as well as the tragic fate of the Aborigines. Instead, they portray the new colony as enjoying an harmonious lifestyle with their neighbors, the good savages. At the end of the 18th century, the population of some 300,000 Aborigines mounted only a weak resistance to the first British arrivals, and as a result, they quickly faced extinction. Considered as inferior and primitive beings, they were chased from their land, ravaged by disease, or massacred. A few members of the Lora tribe did try to resist, but to no avail. The tribe occupied the site of Sydney Cove, but surrendered it to the new arrivals. It became the first English settlement, the Rocks. These colonial buildings and warehouses used to house convicts, whale fishermen, and prostitutes. The once squalid district has since been renovated and transformed into restaurants or shops for tourists. Me From Harbour Bridge, a metal bridge built in 1932 and known by the locals as the Old Coat Rack, we follow the rows of colonial homes in the rocks that leads us to the glass buildings in the Circular Wharf neighborhood. A few steps from the harbour master station, from where the ferries depart, Graham Yan leads us into what was once the customs building. A few years ago, it was converted into a convention centre. Standing beside a scale model of Sydney, he describes the series of events that transformed Australia's oldest town into the modern metropolis it is today.
After the British, there was a change of direction, and we were influenced by American architecture. When steel framing came into buildings and when lifts became important, they made high-rise possible. And the idea of fireproofing buildings was an American concept from Chicago insurance firms. So for probably a 30 to 40 year period from the turn of the century, we had a big influence from American architecture, particularly of the East Coast.
Sydney is situated on one of the most beautiful bays in the world, and many of the city's inhabitants live near the sea. Even those who live in the suburbs, far from the city centre, manage to get to the sea at least twice a day, by taking the ferry to work and back. It's both a duty and a pleasure for Gary, who works at the Taronga Zoo, located north of the bay.
I live in Newtown, which is fairly close to the city. I prefer to catch public transport on a daily basis than drive. There's simply less pollution. I do it for environmental reasons.
The zoo houses an education center where students can closely observe kangaroos, koalas, and numerous other mammals of the marsupial family. 120 such species are indigenous to Australia. Gary is in charge of the Australian Mammals Department. The members of this small community move about in relative freedom. Through his work, Gary has become familiar with each of the animals' characteristics.
Come on, come on.
Such a sweet girl, aren't you? This is Charlotte. She's one of our common wombats. Charlotte must be about... she must be about a bit older than two at the moment. She came to us... her mum had been killed by a car. And Charlotte was found in her pouch. You can see that Charlotte's little pouch there. Okay, she's a marsupial. So if and when... oh, no, we don't like displaying it, do we? If and when she has young, they will live in that pouch there. Okay. Charlotte's a nocturnal animal, as lots of marsupials are in Australia, and her preference would probably be to be asleep at this point in time.
Wombats, wallabies, all of these marsupials protected in Taronga make their home in the arid regions of Australia. Paradoxically, even though it's the country's national symbol, 3 million kangaroos are slaughtered each year. For more than a century, they have been the target of cattle breeders trying to protect their pasture land. By the time this spiny anteater has tracked down some ants and Gary has introduced us to a newly arrived possum, the zoo has opened its doors. A a brief stop near the dingo, the Australian dog, and then a final farewell to the koala. This marsupial honors its Aboriginal name, meaning no water, by peacefully sucking on eucalyptus leaves. Kangaroos and koalas. An opera, a metal bridge, red rocks emerging from the desert, multicolored coral radiating up from the blue of the ocean, mysterious paintings and Aborigines. Yet this inventory of Australian stereotypes would not be complete without the image of a young, tanned, athletic body surfing the waves of the Pacific. But how do Sydney's young people actually perceive themselves and their country?
I think
perhaps we have a multicultural society because we're such a young country, and you get a lot of mixes of different things. We don't have certain behavioural patterns. We take a lot from everybody else and all the different countries, and kind of throw them together and make a nice little mix of our own. And
like cultural mongrels sort of something, you know.
Yeah.
It's like we take bits of everything.
I'm at such a young age that I believe my lifestyle is more important than working and making a career for myself. I spend a lot more time having fun and doing outside activities and seeing how I go. And yeah, generally relaxing and take it a bit more seriously later on.
I think it's really important nowadays for us, like we're becoming more and more part of the world, so I spend a lot of time on the internet and, you know, cruising around and seeing what's out there, but also trying to build up a bit of a solid foundation, I guess.
Located about 3,000 kilometers north of Sydney, beyond the Tropic of Capricorn, the Song of Flower arrives in Cairns, the capital of North Queensland. Founded during the gold and pewter rush that North Queensland experienced at the end of the 19th century, Cairns prospered. It was both the railway terminus for the mines and the seaport for the boats that transported ore. In such a vast country, coastal navigation was once the only transportation link between the distant provinces to the north or west and the large metropolises of the southeast, such as Melbourne and Sydney. That era is now in the past, and other forms of transportation exist today. By capitalizing on its proximity to the tropical forests and, above all, the Great Barrier Coral Reef, Cairns has become one of Australia's most popular tourist destinations, as well as an obligatory port of call for cruise ships.
Diving is really easy. We do a short briefing, explain to you the basic skills that you require. We then demonstrate these skills in the water. After this, we take you for a dive. There'll be four people with one instructor, and we take you through a tour of the reef. We take it very slowly and at your pace, so it's very safe and much fun.
aboard one of the hydroplanes that connect cairns to the various diving spots, we skim over some of the 2,600 reefs that make up the Great Barrier Coral Reef. 2,000 kilometers long, from the southern tip of the Tropic of Capricorn all the way to the northern point of Queensland, the Great Barrier Reef is the largest structure comprised of living organisms. The southern section of the reef is generally around 300 kilometers offshore. As it approaches the Cairns region, it's only 30 to 40 kilometers from the coast. The area is inundated with tourist companies that offer day outings aboard powerful motorized catamarans, including two dives. A dream destination for lovers of the deep blue sea.
Presently see here is somewhere between 10 and 15,000 years old, so it's quite young in geological time. The coral is an animal and a plant all in one. It combines those two creatures. The animal can feed on waterborne food like plankton, but it also uses the sunlight, and this is why the coral reef grows here, because of that bright sunlight. You'll be amazed at the variety of very small life. You have small sea slugs, nudibranchs and creatures like this. You also have many types of fishes that live in the burrows, and shrimps and crustaceans, as well as the obvious big creatures like manta rays and turtles and sharks. So all of these creatures, but particularly the small and intricate life, is what is interesting.
How was your dive?
We leave the blue of the Great Barrier Reef and head towards the green tropical forest. Here once again we witness how intensely tourism has developed, at times in fascinating ways. All along its 7-kilometer route, the sky rail offers a veritable flyover of the tropical forest of the Barron Gorges National Park. The cable cars skim the treetops, some trees reaching an impressive height of 50 meters. Nature lovers accustomed to admiring these trees from the ground have an opportunity to survey the forest's natural canopy during this unique excursion. Just before our sky-high adventure ends at the village of Kuranda, the skyrail stops for a moment to give us time to admire a spectacular view. A few hundred meters from here, the peaceful Barron River transforms itself into an impressive 280-meter-high waterfall that cascades into the valley below. We decide to take the old railway line back to Cairns. Even though it's now essentially touristic, compared to the ultra-modern skyrail, it gives us an opportunity to experience a little of the atmosphere of another era. The train was built between 1882 and 1891 and was used to supply the miners of Heberton with fresh supplies during the rainy season, when the land routes became impassable, thus isolating them.
I think the railway is really good for the colonial, you know, you get the feel of the old times and what was happening there. And the Skyrail is good for modern technology. You get to see everything from a modern perspective. But to get the real feeling, yeah, you should, bushwalks are probably the best.
We're back in Cairns by sunset. The Song of Flower is patiently waiting for us. A few hours later, we leave Cairns and sail towards Port Douglas, 100 kilometers farther north, but still in the province of Queensland. Early morning, the Song of Flower drops anchor a few cable lengths offshore from Port Douglas. The tender skillfully maneuvers us through the mangroves that surround the small arm of the sea leading to Port Marina, as it's commonly called by its inhabitants. Although tourist activity here, as it is in Cairns, is targeted primarily towards the Great Barrier Coral Reef, the ambience at Port Douglas is rather that of an elegant seaside resort, attracting a wealthy and hip clientele. Leaving Port Douglas, we head towards the Daintree and Cape Tribulation National Parks. We follow the sugarcane fields for several kilometers and eventually come to Mossman. The excitement and bustle of the town's sugar-producing days are a distant memory. Mossman lives at a slower pace today, complacent in the shade of the 100-year-old oaks, its inhabitants cultivating plants, and a relaxed lifestyle.
Being a tropical area, a lot of these sort of things that you find around the market here grow very easily. And I find in about the last 20 years or so, there's been a much greater interest in gardening and plants, and orchids in particular. Well, originally, I think the town was mostly based on timber, and sugarcane was the first big industry. But over the years, particularly in the last 30 years or so, tourism has developed a lot more.
The humid tropical forest that covered all of Australia millions of years ago now represents a mere 3% of the territory. This natural treasure is entirely concentrated in Queensland. It's the ideal setting for promoting ecotourism, abetted by the almost fanatical zeal of the inhabitants who take great pleasure in introducing tourists to the wealth and diversity of their region's flora and fauna. Such as the Copper River, whose banks are overgrown with mangroves that serve as a refuge for the crocodile. Protected in this manner, the forest has remained so dense that it stretches all the way to the wide sandy beaches. We pass through the lush vegetation near the mouth of the Copper River to join botanist Nick Godfrey in his veritable natural laboratory dedicated to the Australian primordial forest.
Due to a few factors, this rainforest was able to survive here for at least the last 75, 80 million years that we know about. The main reason it wasn't destroyed was volcanic activity didn't occur in this area. We had the Great Dividing Range pushed up about 100 million years ago, which provided a safe refuge or haven for this forest to exist. And also when Australia finally broke away from Antarctica, we managed to stay just ahead of the really cold period, so this forest didn't die out, unlike the southern temperate forests. We have plants here that go back unchanged for 400 million years. Plants like tassel ferns. We have cycads that date back 260 million years. They haven't changed in all that time. Just the general diversity. We have tens of thousands of organisms that make up the whole rainforest. It's not just a few trees here and there. We've got things like this climber here that has its own fingers attached to its leaves. It can climb its way up to the top of the canopy. It's just the diversity of it all, the age of it all, beauty. So there's a big future in ecotourism in North Queensland, the rainforest and the reef, and even our outback.
Once again, we board the Song of Flower and continue on our journey around Australia, heading slightly northward following the coastline of the Cape York Peninsula. Aboard ship, life resumes its normal mode. Teresa, whom everyone calls Tess, is about to serve tea. Tea time is a de rigueur event that occurs punctually every afternoon. As the day draws to a close, Tess returns to her cabin to change into her evening attire, a ritual that has regulated her life for nearly 6 years.
After I graduated at school, I work in the hotel in Manila. So that's one qualification that you will be hired in this type of job. We have 10 months contract a year and then just 2 months to spend our vacation. I go in the Philippines always for 2 months. When we are in port, so I go ashore, do some shopping and make some phone calls. If we are at sea, no choice, just stay in the cabin. I just miss my elder brother. I don't have husband and wife here. Just looking, still looking.
Approach Lizard Island in the early morning. It's believed that James Cook, whose ship had run aground on these shores in 1770, gave the island its name after encountering the numerous little lizards found there.
Well, Lizard Island is the name of the place, and it is a sanctuary. It is a protected island. There is part of this harbor here is again a protected area. There is a zone where we are not allowed to anchor. So we only have a tiny little area where we can anchor. And if we are positioning ourselves wrongly, then the rangers, there are three rangers stationed on the island. They will come and tell us that we have to move the ship.
Access to Lizard Island is restricted. The Song of Flower is one of the few cruise ships authorized to make a stop there. A Aside from a small luxury hotel and a few pleasure boats, the area is almost deserted. It's an Eden-like setting for a day solely devoted to relaxation and enjoying the beach. This evening is set aside to honor the captain and his crew, and especially the ship's personnel, who are scurrying about attending to every last detail, guaranteeing that the image of excellence and luxury that makes the Song of Flower one of the most prestigious cruise liners in the world is maintained.
You have many times the same passengers coming back. We have 30-40% repeaters on any given cruise, and a lot of these people, they find a home because they, or like a second home, because they get to like a particular ship. When people come on board and people that have sailed here before, even when they enter the gangway, very often the crew member remember their names, and they know their habits, they know what drinks they like, they know what preferences they have in the dining room. And when you meet new passengers, straight away these kind of things are noticed, and the next time they don't even have to ask for what they want because it automatically comes.
During the night, our ship sails towards the tip, the extreme northeastern point of Queensland. From here, Papua New Guinea is less than 150 kilometers from the Australian continent. Although navigating this part of the Coral Sea is not really dangerous, a certain amount of experience is imperative. Therefore, an Australian pilot assists the captain between Cairns and Darwin.
Great Barrier Reef is fairly lengthy. It's over 1,200 miles long, so it's very treacherous to those that don't know and are not familiar with the area that we're traversing.
It must have been a terrorist nightmare for the Captain Cooks and the Captain Blys of the world. The Torres Strait divides two oceans, divides the Arafura Sea from the Coral Sea, and it is quite possible up in the Torres Strait to have a high water at one end and a low water at the other, which is only separated by about 14, 15 miles, which of course is very handy if you're going with the tide, because your speed suddenly becomes a reasonable speed. But if you're going into it, of course, you lose all that. They get quite slow, especially on a slow ship.
Once anchored, we board the tender to take us ashore. Cautiously, we approach a shoreline dotted with jagged red rocks, a spot that, even today, is sometimes impossible to reach by road, certainly during the rainy season. By boat, however, we'll be able to step foot on the tip, Australia's most northerly cape.
that done.
Yeah.
All right?
It looks okay. There's a rock there. I turn it at right angles now. I'd come in a bit like that. Okay.
We're standing right at the top of Australia, the northernmost point of the Australian continent. There are still some islands to our right, which are a part of Australia, but this is as far as you can go on the Australian mainland. You go any further north than this and you get wet.
Somerset, a small trading post, was founded in 1863 on Aboriginal soil. Its founder, Frank Jardine, had always dreamed of competing with the powerful English colony of Singapore. Somerset's history belongs mostly to the Jardine family. Frank's son, Alex, accompanied by his wife, a princess of the Samoa Islands, pursued his father's dream, but in vain. The British abandoned Somerset for the better situated Thursday Islands. The Jardines stayed on, desperately working their land with the help of a few Aborigines. After they died, Somerset disappeared, engulfed by the forest. The Aborigines of Cape York began exercising some control over their ancestral lands. Working as rangers, they're able to keep a close watch over their natural heritage. The Aborigines also manage the Pajinka Lodge, a group of comfortable bungalows, where they welcome the rare tourist who's interested in exploring the Aborigine land and culture.
The story of Cape York really starts with the people who lived here themselves, the Aborigines and the Torres Strait Islanders, who may have been here for anywhere between 60,000 and 100,000 years, making it one of the oldest cultures in the world, and very rich and interesting culture.
Having given his last conference on board the ship, Greg will stay on in Cape York, where his friends are eagerly waiting to see him.
The future of this place still lies in the hands of the traditional owners, and I think that's the way that it should remain. But who knows, the world is becoming a much smaller place, and Cape York can't stay isolated forever, I guess.
Direction west. After sailing for 2 days across the Arafura Sea, the Song of Flower arrives in Darwin.
Thank you.
Compared to Australia's great metropolises of the southeast, Darwin, capital of the north, is a modest city of 800,000 residents. The town was founded just a little over a century ago. The climate is hot and humid, and there are cyclones too, that are sometimes violent. The last one to date was Tracy in 1974, that destroyed a major part of the city, isolating it from the rest of the country. Despite all of these climatological constraints, Darwin is a fascinating city. In an Australia which, until very recently, liked to align itself with the white race, Darwin has cultivated a policy of racial indifference by welcoming more than 50 ethnic groups who, for the most part, come from neighboring Asian countries. Without ruling out the hypothesis of a more ancient predecessor of the Aboriginal family of Australian stock, it's known that about 30,000 years ago, a people from Southeast Asia settled in Australia. Following a major drop in the water level associated with the Ice Age, this Indonesian population moved on foot from their homeland to the region of Darwin or New Guinea and towards the Cape York area. Among them were the Larrakians, who are still seeking recognition today.
Our culture, as you can understand, has been fairly severely damaged due to Europeans when they first come here to present day. My people have been basically all but wiped out, and we have gone through a process of bringing back everybody together again, and there are about 1,500 registered Larrakia people. We started a process through the land claim, the Land Rights Act here in the Territory back in 1975, and we had to go through two court cases to give evidence of dreaming sites, sacred sites, our spiritual affiliation and our beliefs, and we're still waiting to this day, and the hand back of our lands should come back through this final process. We're waiting. My position there is to be the spokesperson. I'm employed through the Larrakia Nation to deal with the government. The functions of the nation is basically to do the administrative work that deals with the native title. It's another step in the recognition of the indigenous people of Darwin to be recognised as the traditional owners and the indigenous people from this region.
Indigenous dance, public
man. Yeah. Not content with ignoring the Aborigines, who were forced to wait until 1967 to become citizens in their own right, until the 1970s, the Australian government also supported a White Australia policy aimed at discouraging Asian immigration. Despite these segregationist laws, many immigrants managed to slip through the net of repression, making Darwin the most cosmopolitan of Australian cities.
Very soon after the first settlement began, we had gold rushes in the inland, about 200 kilometres from here, and Chinese people were allowed to come in and work on the gold fields. And within 15 years, we had 8,000 Chinese people in the northern part of the territory and only 800 white people. So the Chinese were the dominant group. Later on, we got industries like pearling, which meant that Malays, Filipinos, Japanese people came here to work in the pearling boats, and they lived here. And the Aborigines, the pearlers, the Chinese miners and the white people all intermingled and created a group of people which is unique in Australia. Australia is predominantly was a country dominated by white people, but in Darwin there was this exception. There was this community which was coloured because of our very particular and colourful history.
Thank you. Following close behind the huge 18-wheelers that crisscross Australia, we head towards Kakadu National Park. First stop, Coinda, on the banks of the Jim Jim River. We are at the end of the rainy season, a period that Aborigines call yeke. Until very recently, the plains were under 3 meters of water. Although they aren't totally dry yet, the roads connecting the different areas of the park are now negotiable. If you're patient, you'll be able to silently observe an extremely rich wildlife population. More than a third of the known bird species in Australia live in Kakadu. While this white eagle peacefully performs its morning grooming ritual, we're off to Ubir, this time in a small craft, since the roads are totally flooded on this part of the journey. So we sail along the ephemeral rivers that wind their way into the middle of the plains. We cross the billabongs, impromptu lakes studded with water lilies. At the onset of the dry season, they disappear as if by magic. Finally, we lose ourselves in the heart of the immense bayou-like forests. The roads soon become passable once again, and we drive onto Ubir, our final destination. Kakadu National Park is one of the wonders of Australia. It's the property of the Aborigines and is leased to the government. With more than 5,000 sites, Kakadu presents the most extraordinary ensemble of rock art in Australia. For the Aborigines, these sites are a source of knowledge of their ancestral traditions. Having no written language, these works constitute the archives of an entire people.
In this site, there is five galleries that are open to the public, but for the Aboriginal people, there is just everywhere. The paintings are everywhere, but a lot of that is tribal lore. There's a lot of places where you can't go unless you have the right initiation. Even the Aboriginal people themselves can't go there unless they've had the right initiations. It's A lot of this area is a very spiritual area. They estimate at least 30,000 years there is artwork. The paintings are on top of each other, so as the land's changed and the animals have changed, so have the paintings, different animals, and basically they're saying that there's plentiful fish around, wallabies, there's plenty of food, so they're basically saying, yeah, this is a good spot to stop and spend some time. That's the contact period. That is when the white men first settled Australia. So that is, in this area, that is the first time that an Aboriginal person has actually seen a white person. So they've recorded it on the wall because it was something very strange to see.
Having reached the end of our Australian journey in the Aboriginal land of Kakadu, we feel as though we've approached, in the space of a short instant, the dream time. This dream time is the basis of Aboriginal mythology that evokes the perpetual wanderings of legendary beings. After having left their mark in the landscape under the depiction of mountains, plains, or running water, they are reborn each night, stranger and more wonderful, in the sacred sky of Kakadu.